But David Byrne wrote to me about this problem with prints, that his prints are turning too dark, or used to turn too dark. So let me now explore with you the settings that you need so that you don't fall into the same problem. Number one, make sure you use your monitor driver and color profile in your computer. So basically, you go to screen resolution in Windows, you go to advanced settings, color management, you see that here, and you click on color management. And here it shows you the monitors. Let's say this is your main monitor, and here you see the ICC profiles. I have deleted all other ones. A lot of them appeared here. I deleted all, I removed them from this remove, and I left only the default color profile for my monitor. Number two, adjust your monitor brightness to 110 candelas and contrast to 80%. When I bought the monitor, it had been preset by the factory at brightness 50, which is, let's call it 50%. It's not 50%, but let's call it 50%. The contrast was maxed out. After measurements, I had to adjust the brightness to 14 and the contrast to 80. Now, the 80% is basically a rule of thumb for all flat panel monitors. I would say between 80 and 85. Now, how did I measure this? How did I get to this? It's a hardware adjustment. So you need to do it from the buttons on your monitor, right? So you click the button wherever it is on your monitor and the menu pops up and it has brightness and contrast. How do you adjust the brightness to be equivalent to 110 candelas? The easiest method is to go to a site such as Tom's Hardware, for example, or find a site that has tested your monitor and go to the portion where it says OSD setup and calibration. And if you go here all the way down to the bottom, you will see that he already measured it and he found 100 candelas to be 14. In my monitor, it was more than 110 candelas when I set it to 14. But if you are between 100 and 120, you're fine for your prints. That's where the prints are located, between 100 and 120, so that whatever you see your monitor will match your prints and they're not going to be overexposed, they're not going to be dark. The other solution is to use something like the X-Rite. The X-Rite comes with a device, a sensor that you put flush to your monitor. You put it on your monitor and it measures a lot of things. And one of the things that it measures is luminance. So you set up the luminance here at, let's say, 100 or 120. And in the next screen, the monitor starts to light up and the sensor is communicating these values and it tells you on the screen whether you should put it down or put it up. So at the same time, you have your screen controls, the buttons on your monitor. Okay, and you adjust it down until it shows you that you are right there at 100 or 110 or 120. You adjust it. You don't need to finish the calibration. And personally, I would not recommend it if you have a good monitor, because I tried it and it resulted in a greenish hue. You don't need to finish the calibration. Just use it all the way to measure the luminance and then stop. Don't go further. And then, of course, record the value. So for me, it was 14. In a different monitor, it's not 14. It's a different value. It depends on the brightness, the total brightness of the monitor, right? So in my case, it was 14. So I don't forget it. I measure, I wrote it down, 14. So if the monitor loses its calibration for whatever reason, I know I have to reset the brightness at 14 and the contrast to 80%. Number three, make sure that everything that relates to color space in your camera, in your computer, everywhere, is set to sRGB color space. If you're using Adobe, you're going to be running a double life, meaning you will be printing in Adobe, but watching images of the internet or uploading files that will be converted to sRGB. So it's better to use sRGB from the beginning and just get done with it. Except the color space where you open the RAW file. For example, when I open up the file in Adobe Camera Raw, I have set it to open as Profoto RGB. Profoto RGB is the widest color space, and your camera always shoots as Profoto RGB. All right. Now, will I see those colors? No. My computer does, though. And that's what's important in editing. But when I actually save the file, when I choose to save it, I will save it at sRGB. If I want to save it Adobe RGB, it will mean that I only have this version of the file for print, because somehow it, in the specific case, it will have better colors with Adobe RGB. These are very rare cases. And then I also save a file at sRGB as well for all other uses, including internet use. Now, as far as the camera profile, I would recommend you go to camera standard. So find the browse profiles, find the matching profile for your camera, and then click here and set it as the save new camera raw defaults, so that from the same camera all files open up with the camera standard profile or whatever profile you want. This is unrelated to this video, but it helps because it affects the contrast. Number four, correct color errors and tint. Color profiles between Adobe, Nikon, Sony, Canon, and all that stuff, they have a different tint. It results in a different tint because color spaces are three-dimensional, so any change in one axis of color affects all the others. Give yourself a break to evaluate the picture with fresh eyes, because your eyes get easily adjusted to the monitor and you think everything is nice, and you send the picture to print and it comes back printed and you say, well, that face is a little yellow. That's why I also say white balance is very important. And in most cases, if you haven't used the white balance card, which are most cases, you don't really know where to click to correctly adjust the white balance. So we have this image, for example, and in this image, which is Adobe Color, it says here, that's how it opened, right? As shot. That's as shot. So you say, I want to correct the white balance. So you do this here, boing, and oopsie. Why did it turn like that? Well, because this is not white. Whatever white you have, and you know it's actual white, has to be in focus. Because out of focus, the Voigtlander 58, for example, produces strong chromatic aberrations. In this case, this white was not white, but aberrated. Your eyes see it white, but it's not white. Let's try this one. That's even worse, because it's in the shade. That's a little bit better, but not exactly right there. So you see, if you don't have a white card, it becomes very, very difficult, right? So here's a quick solution. If the in-shot picture looks otherwise nice, but then you print it and it will look a little yellowish, as a matter of fact, the face, do this. First of all, go and, as I said, set it to a camera matching profile, as we have see standard, which is the closer approximation of Adobe for your camera profiles. And then, especially when you have faces, and that's going to be our next step, which is know that prints are not backlit like your monitor is. Your monitor is backlit, the prints are not. They have less dynamic range. So dark will appear darker and highlights will be white or almost like white out, completely unattractive. So what do you do in this case? Well, here I have a face, right? And half of the face is lit by the sun directly. The other half is in the shade. In the monitor, it looks fine because it's backlit. In reality, I know, and that has you have to know from experience, that it's not going to look very good. And the same with the shadow here. You're going to have a lot more contrast in the printed image. So what do? You lower the highlights, increase a little bit the shadows. That's a cheap method to do it, right? I mean, that's a quick, stupid method to do it, but it works. Trust me, it works. And look now, the before and the after. And I'm not sure if you can see it on YouTube, because it will change the colors probably. But if you look the before and the after is, it's gonna render much better on the print, and the color too. Look at the color in the before, where you had the wrong color profile, and a feeling of yellowish tint all over the picture, which is greatly subsided here, and the face looks a little more lively and without that much contrast. As a matter of fact, this was a terrible idea to raise the exposure here, maybe over here. And if my candelas, if the monitor is at 110 candelas, this is gonna print exactly like that. Well, not exactly, but very, very close to that. Now, if you want to make them a little more Canon-like, you can experiment here with a little of the saturation of the orange, give it a little bit, and about double in the luminance of the orange. And you see now the face looks more like Canon colors, right? On the right. Which is also a method for Fuji users who still refuse to use the little flash to fix this. This is with a Fuji XH1 to fix this completely unattractive waxy skin tones that they're getting when they're not using flash, and there's no exposure correction that will actually fix it by basically going into the color module, raise the oranges a little bit, raise the orange both saturation a little bit, the saturation, but more the luminance, and hopefully you will get a better result if you definitely want to print it out. At least it's going to look more alive, more like real skin and not waxy. Which brings me to number 6, which is irrelevant to the editing process to prepare pictures for print, but it's the most important of all: use flash. As I've shown you before in this picture is absolutely impossible. This is straight out of camera, straight out of camera. And it's absolutely impossible to take, to produce this picture, which will print perfectly. This picture will print perfectly. The only thing I have to do is to lower the luminance here on the tree, because I didn't point the flash correctly, and it lit up part of the tree. But other than that, it will be absolutely impossible to get this face skin tones perfect and everything with just raising exposure or doing localized adjustment and bullshit like that. Far, far easier to just use flash. There are no adjustments here. Just put on the camera, flash TTL. That's it, automatic. You don't need to torture yourself with manual adjustments. Look at this without flash. How on earth are you gonna save that? You know that if you print that, the face is gonna look—it's gonna be completely black. Well, not black, but it's gonna be a lot darker than what you see in the monitor, and with stronger contrast. I didn't use flash here, and I cannot fix that now. Flash is also going to reveal the sharpness of your lens. Otherwise, it's gonna be dull and dark. Take a look at this image, for example. That's got problems because I didn't use flash. I should have used the flash with a little funnel, with a little tube on the flash head, in order to direct flash towards the face area. Okay, because right now the face, most of the face is dark, there is strong contrast, and if you print this out, the face is gonna be dark with strong contrast. It's gonna look as if the eyes have heavy makeup, and the hair is going to look black all the way down to here on the print, whatever print paper you choose. Okay, so what happened is that I had to do localized adjustments instead in editing. But editing means change of color. Remember that? Editing means change of color. So by doing localized adjustments on the face, I raised up the face, and I slaved myself about half an hour playing with colors until I get an acceptable color on the face. Revealed the hair, so I did localized adjustments in this area. Okay, at the same time I had to do some global adjustments like raising the shadow and reducing the highlights, which is also a change of color. Let me show you why. Because when you're here on the right and you raise the shadows, the only thing that you're doing is that you are making the colors more bright, more light. So the green turns into a green grayish. Okay, the beautiful vibrant green of these branches here, look at how washed out it looks in the edited image. And that's just raising the shadows. That's all it is, raising the shadows. So ideally, I should have the entire image as is on the right, but with only more light in the area of the face. That's where the flash comes in. And it's far easier and quicker too, because I don't need any editing afterwards. After you're done and you're satisfied on your monitor, choose a good lab for your test prints and order luster paper. No matte paper, no glossy paper. Luster. And not metallic, because metallic is high contrast paper. Preferably a small lab where you can talk to the guy and ask him on the phone, is the image properly exposed or should I have exposed a little higher or lower? He's going to tell you. And finally, number 8, compare the prints with your monitor, how they look on your monitor. Is it the same luminosity and brightness? And I'm not talking about areas that are in the shade, very dark areas. The monitor always has an advantage here, because it's higher dynamic range. I'm talking about the main subject. Here the main subject is the girl. Does the girl look the same on the monitor as it looks on my print? Is it satisfactory? If it is satisfactory, you're done. That's it. From now on, your prints will look like your monitor. If it's not satisfactory, adjust your monitor accordingly. And that's it pretty much. Thanks a lot. Bye.